I was able to custom tailor exact doses for each individual patient.
And you're compounding estradiol, estriol. What does that mean? What are they putting in it?
But yeah. I've had doctors call me and tell me, what can I brew up? Like I'm a witch with a cauldron.
So I'm so happy to have you here today.
Thank you.
You're welcome. For our podcast listeners, this is Dr. Emily Yop.
Hello.
She is our new hormone specialist at ZüpMed. And Emily, I don't know a tremendous amount about what led you to us today. So why don't you share just a tiny smidge about your career?
That's a great question. So for about the last 10 years, I've been working in the hormone, managing thyroid, just sort of general endocrine disorders. I had worked in a compounding pharmacy where I really became accustomed to talking with women that either were not doing well on traditional hormone replacement therapy or just looking for alternatives, whether that be a dosing adjustment or dosage form adjustment, and just really began, that really kickstarted my interest and my passion for learning more and more about it.
Well, we're so lucky to have you at ZüpMed.
Thank you.
So aside from introducing you, our new hormone specialist, I think that we need to really address the hormone situation that everyone is seeking right now. We need to probably talk about what is a hormone. If you're on certain types of hormones, are you at risk? And who and how should you be monitored when you're on hormonal-based therapy?
Yes, all very important discussion points.
Why don't we start with just tell me what a hormone's job description? What's a hormone's job description?
So hormones are, at the end of the day, chemical messengers in our body. They are what define us as male and female. They are what kickstarts puberty and and those changes. But as you get older and hormones decline, it's the decline that really can perpetuate and stimulate some of these age-related declines, such as cardiovascular diseases, bone density changes. You've got hormone receptors all over your body. They're not just for menstrual cycles and having babies.
So if I'm interested in aging gracefully, hormones then would be something that I should look into.
Definitely something that you should look into. I was listening to a podcast from another well-known medical doctor who, as bluntly as it sounds, she said, hormones are going to, everybody's going to die, but hormones will make you die more gracefully and slower.
Well, great.
Pretty blunt, but
Sign me up.
There's no avoiding those, those two things.
Yeah. You know, right now there are so many hormone options. We have people who come to us who have been to different specialties, and hormones come in all shapes and sizes. You coming from a compounding world certainly know quite a bit about FDA-approved products and then compounded products. You want to talk a little bit about what the difference is between a synthetic hormone and a bioidentical hormone is?
Sure. So I think the lock and key analogy is the best way to describe synthetic hormones versus bioidentical hormones. So let's say, for example, I take my house key and go to your house. I can probably put it in your front door, but it's not going to turn the lock, and it's probably going to get stuck there. Bioidentical hormones are identical in structure to what your body was naturally producing in its reproductive years, and it is designed to perfectly fit in the receptor. And any hormone, back to the first question, works by binding to a receptor to elicit a response. So if it's a synthetic hormone, it doesn't bind completely correctly. And yeah, you're right. There is a ton of hormone replacement therapy offered. I've seen it offered at almost wellness clinics, spas, all sorts of things. And it really has become the wild, wild west, I think.
I see that. We see lots of women who've come in who have received probably inappropriate doses or dosage forms, and we'll talk about that maybe in a minute, that have led to symptoms like hair loss or anger or irritability or acne.
Increased hair growth.
Sure.
And what they
In places
you don't want it. Yeah. And what they probably aren't being told is a lot of these symptoms are irreversible. So even after you stop the offending drug or whatever may be causing it, sometimes these for instance, the increased hair growth in places you don't want it, those hair follicles don't just go away when you stop using the medication. So it can be irreversible in some cases.
Yeah, that kind of scares me.
It should. Yeah. It very much should.
Yeah. So let me go back to something that you asked and or stated earlier, and that is the monitoring piece about people who are receiving hormones from other places. And I certainly want to talk about mm-hmm. how our philosophy at ZüpMed and why we monitor and what our practice is at ZUP. We certainly don't want to
sure.
discourage anyone, but we want to encourage safety first. Because it is the wild, wild west and because there are so many different varying practices, how is a woman supposed to start? How do you even begin to understand who to go to and why?
For sure. So I always begin with sitting down with my patients for at least 45 minutes to an hour. I want to get a thorough background on them. What are their main symptoms? What is your past medical history? Your family's past medical history? What have you tried or not and not done well on? As far as monitoring goes, there are blood labs or serum labs that you can monitor, but that doesn't always give you a complete picture of particularly estrogen metabolism. And that is one hormone that should not be feared or avoided, but needs to be monitored in a much more broad view of mm-hmm. how your body uses it. And everybody has their own genetic profile and different SNPs that maybe make you more prone to metabolizing it down in a more inflammatory pathway or a more genotoxic pathway. Mm-hmm. And those are things that you obviously want to avoid if you can, and you know about it, but you wouldn't know without the testing. So we have, of course, genetic testing. We have the option to do DUTCH, which stands for a dried urine test for comprehensive hormones. Mm-hmm. If I recall, that's the acronym. Mm-hmm. That gives you a very clear picture of the breakdown of estrogen in your body. Mm-hmm. We have saliva testing, which can show also the metabolites, but also more of a tissue level. Mm-hmm. how the hormone is acting at the tissue level, not just what's circulating in general in your mm-hmm. bloodstream. Mm-hmm. So, you know, not every patient needs all of these tests. I definitely, part of the past medical history goes into determining, because, mm-hmm. You know, I don't want to run a necessary test for sure.
Sure.
But if you do have a past medical history of, or family history of female cancers or strokes or, you know, blood clots, those are things that if we know, we can avoid.
Yeah, yeah.
And treat in a safer route.
Yeah. I think one other additional test that you did not mention was stool. You know,
we can
the gut kind of reharvests or mm-hmm. utilizes mm-hmm. estrogen and puts it back into the systemic circulation. And so some women need maybe a stool test mm-hmm. to see if their estrogen level is appropriate or not. And I think this goes into our philosophy at ZUP about the need mm-hmm. for an individualized approach.
Absolutely.
I've actually the guidelines there are a lot of practices mm-hmm. that don't monitor at all except for symptoms, and I think for me, and I'm curious to hear your mm-hmm. Take on this, but mm-hmm. for me, when a man gets a hormone, mm-hmm. the endocrine guidelines give monitoring parameters for men.
Yeah,
if you are a person who is transitioning to another gender, there are endocrine guidelines that suggest monitoring for the transgender population. Mm-hmm. You're a woman.
Good luck.
Exactly. I think we've been kind of shortchanged on this.
Absolutely. And I think there is definitely a disservice to women. I think if it were a man's problem, it would have been solved 30 years ago or before beginning of man time. But I digress.
No offense to you, Lloyd, who's probably listening, Dr. Finks out there.
But there was a very flawed study back in the 90s, Women's Health Initiative, that mm-hmm. really, now in hindsight, is completely being debunked and all the flaws pointed out of it. But, you know, it started out testing to see if hormones are safe in women. Mm-hmm. But they were using synthetic hormones, mm-hmm. not bioidentical. Mm-hmm. They were not even, they were doing just estrogen and then an estrogen progestin study. And they pulled the study early because they said it was causing cancer and heart attacks in women.
A lot of it was flawed because the messaging was, although the mathematics were mm-hmm. suggesting that there was a trend, mm-hmm. it it completely got misbranded and mismessaged to not only the physician population, mm-hmm. but to women in general. And mm-hmm. I like to quote a physician. She's an OB, and her mm-hmm. name is Dr. Felice Gersh. Mm-hmm. And she said the study was like looking at a particular strawberry-flavored jelly bean. Mm-hmm. And that strawberry flavored jelly bean was not good for it did not show the outcome that was expected. Mm-hmm. But the message that came out of that study was never eat another strawberry again. So it's completely unrelated.
Correct. Yeah.
Because the synthetic hormones are going to do something different than a more 100%. Natural human identical or bioidentical hormone.
100%. So yeah. To approach each individualized patient, individualized care, I do think to test is best. I don't ever just guess on hormone dosing mm-hmm. For all the reasons that we talked about as far as different metabolic pathways of estrogen in particular, testosterone. You know, that's something that it's become real popular to get in pellets, which that's we'll talk about in a minute. But to test is best, but also, you know, I do like to talk to them and get their symptoms and are you feeling better or worse? Because, you know, not everybody feels good on the same dose. And that's really where in my compounding experience, I was able to custom tailor mm-hmm. exact doses for each individual patient.
Yeah. And you're compounding estradiol, estriol. So these mm-hmm. are human identical or bioidentical mm-hmm. hormones. And each pharmacy or the compounding pharmacies that you have worked at have been accredited. I think mm-hmm. a lot of times people are like, ooh, compounding.
Sure.
What does that mean? What are they putting in it?
But yeah. I've had doctors call me and tell me, what can I brew up? Like I'm a mm-hmm. witch with a cauldron.
We both graduated from the same university. So, yeah.
But, you know, if you understand compounding and know that we can't work with anything that's not, doesn't have a USP monograph or is not already from a FDA approved medication, mm-hmm. then that ought to make you feel a little bit better that we're not just getting kitty cat tails and whatever to make medicine. But the customization there is really what yeah. is I want to hit home with because, you know, if you are, the commercially available hormone replacement therapies only come in 2 to 4 strengths. And mm-hmm. if you're not the unicorn that fits one of those doses, well, then what do you do?
Right.
And so just knowing that there's other options, there's not, yeah. it's not a one size fits all approach at all.
Right. And at ZUP, we're always going to take a very personalized approach.
Yes, absolutely.
To you.
And I met with a patient today that she wanted a natural approach. She wanted to start with supplementation and herbs and adaptogenics and before mm-hmm. we started hormones. And mm-hmm. I mean, I support that decision too. Mm-hmm. You know, as long as it's first do no harm, as long as it's safe
right.
and her labs show that, then I'm fine for that
right.
support as well.
And you have that expertise and
yes,
we're grateful for that.
Yes, a lot of experience working with supplements and herbs.
That's
for sure.
Great. You know, for us, it's a first do no harm. You mentioned that. Mm-hmm. Second, always, we want to bring that quality of life to that person.
Oh,
so
yeah.
symptom control, but we also are very concerned with the mismessaging in current times, not only in the times of the Women's Health Initiative, but in current times in the wild, wild west, as we mm-hmm. said, oh, pellets are the best thing for you because they're going to give you doses that you had in your 20s and they're mm-hmm. going to make you feel great. Mm-hmm. So let's explore just a minute the downsides of pellets. And what does that mean? What is a pellet?
So a pellet is a hormone-embedded implant that is implanted into your gluteus maximus, minimus.
The butt tissue.
There you go. Implanted there, and it dissipates drug over about 3 to 4 months before you go in for your next pellet. Personally, what I don't like about it is let's say you don't do well on that dose or you don't like the side effects. Well, you can't remove it.
Right.
It is there until it completely, I just sort of picture it fizzling out or running mm-hmm. out of battery.
Mm-hmm.
And I just don't love that idea.
Yeah. And what happens if the outside edge doesn't elude drugs slowly over time.
Oh, yes. So that you end up on a hormone roller coaster. You really do, with higher levels when it's initially in place, and then it fizzles out, like I said, and by month two or three, you're not getting hardly any hormones, but it's still not time for your next one. So you just really end up on this hormonal roller coaster, which, newsflash, when you're going through perimenopause, that's why you feel the way you do. You're on a hormone roller coaster.
Yeah.
Not because of anything implanted in your body. It's just your ovaries deciding to play or not play one day.
Why would anyone want to get on this ride?
Correct. Yeah. I could write a book on all of
maybe we should
women that are at the end of the day, I just want to educate my patients based off of their own personal lab results, their symptoms, and what decision makes the most sense for them.
Yeah.
Make a shared decision.
Absolutely.
I want to offer them options. I want to meet them where they are. If they don't want to go on medication, well, sure, let's try some vitamins and minerals and herbs and things like that. But the more conversations I've had with women that have not done well on pellets, the more sad I am for them, because they were not always discussed the risk-benefit, possible side effects.
Yeah.
It doesn't seem that monitoring is being done correctly. I mean, if you're drawing labs right before you put in a new pellet, you're reaching trough levels. You're never seeing peak levels, which peak levels are what can cause harm or, you know, if they're too high. And other vitals don't seem to be monitored correctly. So, for example, if a female is given too much testosterone, they usually feel pretty good at first. I mean, they've got great energy. Maybe they're noticing their body composition change. But over time, your body knows that's not what you need, and it tries to correct itself. Your body's trying to maintain homeostasis at all times. And so the only thing your body can do with testosterone is convert it to estrogen and begin the metabolism out of your body. So when a female gets too much estrogen, they become in an estrogen-dominant state oftentimes. And with that comes the weight gain, the puffiness, breast tenderness, bleeding after you've been in menopause for years.
Yeah.
And those are all things that should be alarming.
Yes.
So
I think that, you know, if someone has had a bad experience with pellets, there's hope, because there are people like you out there who can approach this in a safer and a lower dose way, in a way that meets their needs. And
correct.
So,
it really does not take a high dose of hormones to resolve symptoms and restore levels.
Yeah. Let's talk about one other dosage form that I don't consider safe, and
I know where you're going with this.
Okay. So oral estradiol or oral estrogen. And it's amazing to me about how many of my friends are on oral, and I have to educate them that maybe that's not the best dosage form and why. So you want to
It comes right back around to the estrogen metabolism that I was talking about earlier. Anytime you take medication by mouth, whether we're talking Advil or estradiol, it goes through your gut, gets metabolized through your liver, and is excreted, urine, stool, you know, it's on its way out, comes in one end, out the other. And with estrogen, it does get metabolized through the liver, and one of those breakdown metabolites is another version of estrogen called estrone. And that is the metabolite that is the more inflammatory. There's still three or four different versions of estrone, but in general, they are very inflammatory and also genotoxic. So that Women's Health Initiative drug study that gave hormones such a bad name was using oral synthetic estrogen. And the women were having heart attacks and strokes, and and I'm sure you people have read about the risks of hormones and cancer. And I don't want to be insensitive or discredit, but I really think that estrogen was given a bad name because of the dosage form.
Sure.
So estrogen can be replaced and replenished in a female through topical administration, whether that is through a compounded cream or the topical patches. Or there's even a spray, a mist that you can apply to your skin. And so you're still, hormones are very lipophilic, meaning they love fat. They are very easily absorbed through your skin. And so topical administration replenishes hormone levels without going through the liver to such an extent that the oral would, and creating those inflammatory metabolites.
Yeah. They're not the standards out there that are needed because the research 20 years ago led us all astray from hormones. And 100%. So, yeah. So we're coming around, though. We're gaining knowledge. We do have literature that supports testing and understanding estrogen metabolism. And I think we have dosage forms that are absolutely safe, that can provide symptom relief, that can provide heart benefit, that can provide bone benefit, where you aren't giving super physiologic doses and causing high blood pressure, your hair to fall out, anger issues, acne, hair growth, another place. You know, we have, it's 2024, we have the means to provide safe and individualized hormone care.
We absolutely do, and we would love to help you.
That's great. If someone wants to come and see you, of course, they can go to our website, ZüpMed.com. They can book online. This is a hormone specialist visit with you. They can also call our front desk, 901-701-7010, and talk to our front desk about their specific needs. And I welcome anyone to come and see you because I'm so grateful to have you on our team.
I look forward to being able to help more people.
That's great. Thanks, Emily.
Thank you.